Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
As much as we might say the past doesn't matter, let's look at the present and look forward to the future. The past does matter, particularly the past in the history of a very young republic such as India. This is the 70th year of the republic. It's also a couple of years away from being the 75 years since we became independent. So there is still a great deal of oomph in the history of independence movement. What happened between the great leaders of that movement? That pantheon is led by Nehru, Gandhi, Gandhi, Nehru, Patel, Subhash Chandra Bose, and so on. Why? Because that past is not irrelevant. Much of today's politics, much of today's ideological binaries come from that past. Before the constitution came into effect, in fact, India has had a kind of an all-party government. The idea was to have a consensus cabinet, so everybody got together to start building a new nation. Yet, a lot of the thought processes then ran contrary to each other. Nehru had one line of thinking, Patel had another line of thinking, Gandhi had yet another line of thinking, especially on India's industrial and economic policies. Rajaji, Chakravarti Rajgopalachari, had a completely radically different view on the economy. But these diverse people came together because the great mission was to build India, a new modern India. And as that India evolved, different thought processes evolved along different lines. There was also Jayaprakash Narayan leading his socialists. And then many of these became individual parties, individual ideologies, and then enriched India's politics. And much of the fight within India's politics, democratic politics, has been among the adherents of many of these thought processes, ideologies, and lines of thinking. So Indian nationalism was not defined in a very narrow sense, and Indian national thought was not defined in any narrow sense, including in the Congress Party, which was the fountainhead from which the freedom movement grew and India attained freedom. Congress was an umbrella party. It was much more than a mere political party. It became a political party later. So having given that sort of complex background, and I hope I've been able to state this to you in a decluttered enough manner, I come to the point of our discussion today. And that point is the same old perennial story of the Patel-Nehru equation at the time of independence. Now, several things have happened. One, a new book has come out, and this is a book, you will see the title on the screen. This is the book written by Narayani Basu, who is a great-granddaughter of VP Menon, who was a kind of self-made bureaucrat. He started out as a typist, rose to a very high level, and played a stellar and very important role in those tumultuous and eventful and fateful days and hours and minutes and months when India got its independence and India got partition, and also when all the states were put together. The other very useful thing VP Menon did was that he collected a lot of archival material. He wrote a lot of archival material. He had a great memory. He gave many interviews. So his works and his recollections and his archives help us understand that period very well, the highest level to which he rose. I mean, he had many titles and many levels, but I would say that was constitutional advisor to Lord Mountbatten, who was the last British Governor General. Now, his great-granddaughter has relied on his papers, his interviews, but also on a book written by a gentleman called H.V. Hodgson, who wrote a book called The Great Divide, Britain, India and Pakistan in 1970. Where he referred to a conversation with Lord Mountbatten, which then confirms something that Narayani Basu says. Her great-grandfather had said in an interview, the recordings of which are available in an archive, which she went and referred to. Now, in that interview, VP Menon said that he was aghast in the, and Narayani Basu says, somewhere in the first week of August 1947, he was aghast when he discovered that Sardar Patel's name was not in the list of the cabinet ministers that Nehru was going to submit to Mountbatten to be sworn in as independent India's first cabinet. Now, she said that Menon was aghast, and Menon went running to Mountbatten and he said, a bit like, ab ye anarth ho jayega. After this, there will be an immediate power struggle. Congress will break up. This country will get divided. Don't let this happen. And then that Mountbatten intervened with Nehru, told him to do no such thing, and was able to persuade Nehru to include Patel's name. Now, this plays beautifully into the current debate in the country. Just last week, in parliamentary debate, Prime Minister Modi referred to Nehru 23 times in his speech. Not one of the 23 references was flattering of Nehru, because in the RSS BJP reading of history, and I'm not judging anybody's reading of history, everybody has a right to read history their own way, as long as they stick to facts and refer to relevant and authentic archives. But in their worldview, the reading of that history means that there was this great tussle between Nehru and Patel. They disagreed with each other very strongly in many areas, but especially on nationalism, on Kashmir, on Hinduism, on Somnath temple, on partition, etc., etc. Patel was more competent than Nehru, but Nehru manipulated things in such a way that Gandhi edged out Patel and preferred Nehru instead. So that is the folklore that is believed by the parties, by the party and ideology that's in power right now. And as happens in India, once a party and an ideology acquires power, particularly with a majority, then a lot of the commentariat, a lot of the intelligentsia also sprouts around it, repeating the same ideas. And now that the Prime Minister mentioned this 23 times, the issue had already become quite hot, and the background for this came in Narayani Basu's book. So you should read that book. In fact, you see the jacket, as I said, on the screen. Please go check out that book. As also check out Jairam Ramesh's book on Krishna Menon, which is of a different period, of a later period, but still gives you a sense of the kind of documentation, say, Nehru and Patel were keeping, and what Nehru was writing about various issues happening at that time, because he was writing a lot of that detail to Krishna Menon in his letters. Now what has happened is, because these claims have been made, so a lot of the people are saying, dekha, humne pehle hi bola tha. Nehru was such a mean fellow that he had actually left out Patel's name for his first cabinet list. He did not even want him in the cabinet. What a terrible man, Nehru. But then a counter comes, and counter again comes from facts and archives and historians. So the best counter so far has been written by Srinath Raghavan, who is a former army officer, but among India's finest contemporary historians. Also a brilliant military historian. He is now a professor at Ashoka University, scholar in his own right. He writes quite often on the print. So he wrote an article for the print referring to a bunch of documents, archives and dates. And I am following some of that. And if you want, you can check out each one of these documents on the web. Some we will play on screen also, including some archival papers from the Partition of India documents. Now, as Srinath says, these days we are all being told to understand chronology very well. To understand this chronology, India becomes independent on 15th of August 1947. So work backwards from that. I would begin from 19th of July, but let me leave 19th of July at this point as a little mystery. I will come back to it in 2 minutes. So first of all, on 28th of July is when Menon says that Mountbatten told Nehru that he had problems with his cabinet. And that is a well-recorded archive. Again, this has been recorded by Lord Mountbatten. You can see it on the screen. So Lord Mountbatten said that in the meeting, and this is after Nehru had submitted his first list of cabinet members, he said at Menon's bidding, he said that, look, this is not a ministry of talents. You are accommodating too many of your old friends and you are answering too many of your old loyalties. So get rid of some of them, get more talented people, because if you don't get talented people, then this government will not last a very long time and Congress will not last more than a year. But if you draw more younger talent, more people will come in and your government may last. And Mountbatten records that after he said this, there was sensation. And he's written that very sensationally with two exclamation marks after that. Sensation, one word sentence, two exclamation marks. And then he says, he records it. When Congress party had its meeting after that on deciding the cabinet, his information was that Patel sided with my, quote unquote, my point of view. That means Mountbatten's point of view that cabinet should have younger people. So first of all, not only was Patel not excluded on 28th of July, he actually was playing a key role in deciding who should get in the cabinet. And Mountbatten's specific objections were about Chakravarti Rajgopalachari and Maulana Azad. As it turned out later, Jawaharlal Nehru, as happens in politics, you give some, you take some, or you keep some. He dropped C. Rajgopalachari, persuaded him to become a governor, but retained Maulana Azad. So this is 28th of July. After that comes 1st of August. 1st of August, once again, Mountbatten meets Nehru and specifically tells him that, look, you should have a younger cabinet, drop Rajaji and drop Maulana Azad. He could not have met Nehru earlier because 30th and 31st of July 1947, Lord Mountbatten was in what was then Calcutta, now Kolkata. So first he comes back and he meets Nehru and tells him this. Again, this meeting is archived and it's an archive that you can very easily access as we have and as is also referred to in Srinath's article. So you can see it once again. This is an archive. Mountbatten also looks like he used to like, he liked gossip as well. Who doesn't like gossip? And he was sitting on the top, seeing a nation come into being. In fact, two nations come into being. So he was also having fun. Maze leke, usne bhi likha hai. And he says that Jayaprakash Narayan also put up a price for the socialists to join the cabinet. According to him, what did the socialists want? What did JP want? They wanted finance, home, and Ministry of the States, which at that point was a very important ministry. In fact, that is the ministry that Sardar Patel got, because that ministry, this new federation was to come up now, that ministry was very vital. So because socialists wanted finance, home, and Department of the States, socialists were not given any of this. And Mountbatten again records that there is no way Congress would have agreed to give this much to socialists. So Congress then decided to reach out to Hindu Mahasabha. That's how Shyama Prasad Mukherjee joined the cabinet. Now, this is 1st of August when this meeting takes place between Mountbatten and Nehru. There is no mention of Patel not being there and it's been recorded by Mountbatten. In between, on 30th of July, everything is moving very fast. Independence is 15 days away. On 30th of July, Nehru writes to Patel. And Nehru writes to Patel mentioning that he is talking to Ambedkar, persuading him to join. And Patel is also talking to Ambedkar, persuading him to join the cabinet. At one point, Nehru writes to Patel that Ambedkar has agreed, although he is saying as law minister, I will not have enough to do. But I am telling him that this is in this government, a new cabinet, everybody will have a lot more to do. So you join in. So all this stuff is going on at that time. So 30th July is the reference to Patel. And he also then writes to Patel that you reach out to Shyama Prasad Mukherjee and R.K. Shanmukham Chetty. None of them is from the Congress party, to persuade them to join. And also to Raja Ji to accept a governorship of West Bengal. All this is going on in that period. 1st of August, once again, since Narayani Basu's book says, August 1st week, her great-grandfather told Mountbatten that Patel was being excluded. There is a letter written by Nehru to Patel on 1st of August, where he says, as formalities have to be observed to some extent, I'm writing to invite you to join the new cabinet. This writing is somewhat superfluous. You are the strongest pillar of this government. So no doubt, once again, that on 1st of August itself, Nehru has invited Patel to join his cabinet. Then how do the doubts emerge? Doubts emerge because VP Menon has later said in an interview to H.V. Hodgson, whose book we mentioned earlier, his book, The Great Divide, Britain, India, Pakistan, in which he made this mention that he realized this and he was aghast and he went to Mountbatten. Mountbatten was aghast. So Hodgson speaks to Mountbatten and Mountbatten responds to him in March of 1970. Mountbatten is obviously fairly grown up by now. March of 1970, Mountbatten says, this story does ring a faint bell with me. I have a feeling that this was such a hot potato that I probably just mentioned it quickly to Nehru and made a point of not recording it anywhere and probably not even of passing on the story. This is March 1970. Now, this is the reference to which Narayani Basu has, on which Narayani Basu has made this claim. This book, as we know, was released by Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar, who is also a scholar, has a doctorate from JNU. He wrote a tweet which was a bit, not fully, but a bit of an endorsement of this argument, and he said there should be more debate, to which Ram Guha then responding, saying that ministers should read books and know their history, to which again Jaishankar, and I am sure this is all a friendly fist fight, Jaishankar responds by saying ministers also read books. Similarly, professors should also read books, whereby he means that Ram Guha should also read Narayani Basu's book, to which Ram Guha then responded again with facts, quoting from Srinath Raghavan's article on the print. So the print is in the middle of a lot of this. And Jairam Ramesh put out a couple of tweets listing some of the documents. These are publicly available documents, widely quoted, widely known. Everybody who studies the subject knows about these documents. So those documents also we are once again sharing with you for reference, because these help us declutter that period. So now we are sitting at on 1st of August. Now go a little bit ahead of 1st of August. On 3rd of August, Sardar Patel writes to Nehru, because first Nehru has invited him to join the cabinet. Third, Sardar Patel writes to Nehru. Once again, an archived letter available to you. You can check it out. He says, our attachment and affection of each other and our comradeship for an unbroken period of nearly 30 years. He refers to that. And he says, this admits of no formalities. So no formalities are needed, because Nehru had said it's a formality that I have to invite you to join. I am completing that formality. So he says our comradeship and friendship of 30 years doesn't require any formalities. And then he goes on to write, my services will be at your disposal, I hope, for the rest of my life, and you will have my unquestioned loyalty and devotion in the cause for which no man in India has sacrificed as much as you have done. This is Patel talking to Nehru. They had many differences, but they were also very close comrades who had fought for a great cause together. And then he goes on to say, this is Patel writing, our combination is unbreakable and that is our strength. Now, how does then all this tie up? So we switch decades again. In March of 1970, Lord Mountbatten tells H.V. Hodgson, that he has a faint memory that something like this happened. Probably he might have mentioned it to Nehru because it must have been such a hot potato, but made no mention of it. 28th of May, the same year, 1970, Sarvepalli Gopal, who is a biographer of Nehru and a very scholarly biographer, the best, he interviews Mountbatten. And Mountbatten then says to him on 28th May, this is 2 months after he has spoken with Hodgson. He said, I had heard some rumors like that, but I don't have much recollection that such a thing happened. So if he said the other thing in March, why is he saying this in May? And that interview, once again, is not based on Sarvepalli Gopal's memory. It's a recorded interview which is available in Sarvepalli Gopal's archives. The most beautiful thing about people of those times was that they archived everything. They wrote stuff, they recorded it, they left their papers behind. Frankly, going ahead, we don't know what happened between Vajpayee and Advani. We might know some of that. I don't know what our grandchildren will be able to research and how will they research what happened between Narendra Modi and Amit Shah. Because this is the same formula, Nehru, Patel, Vajpayee, Advani, Narendra Modi, Amit Shah. So that generation, because they had come from a certain background, they were also very literate. They left a lot of work, lot of stuff for us to pursue. Now, I had told you earlier that I'm leaving 19 July aside and I will come back to it. So I am now coming to 19 July. When you go back to 19 July, that is the first time that Congress Party has produced a list of new cabinet members. 19th of July, and that list has gone out to Mountbatten as well. And frankly, that is the list in response to which Mountbatten is saying, this will not wash, you have too many old people, you need more talent. Effectively, you also need a more wider-based cabinet. Who are the ministers in that? Again, it's an archived letter. The first list of cabinet members of 19 July 1947. Number one name, the first name, Sardar Patel. Second name, Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. Third name, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who later became President of India. Fourth name, Dr. John Mathai. Fifth, Rajgopalachari. Sixth, Sardar Baldev Singh, who became Defence Minister of India. Then Jagjivan Ram, the same Jagjivan Ram who later became Deputy Prime Minister. C.H. Bhabha, and the last name, yes, last but not the least, as they say, Jawaharlal Nehru himself. And as you can see, changes took place subsequently, and the important name that was dropped from this list was Jawaharlal Nehru. And Nehru also goes on to say in his letter to Sardar Patel that, look, right now this is a provisional government and this will expand and more people will come in. So right now people will continue with the portfolios they hold, because India had an elected government even before independence with limited powers. People will continue to hold their portfolios, but five ministers who were from Muslim League, in fact, Nehru in his letter says five of the Pakistanis, because they were now becoming Pakistanis, who go away, for now their portfolios will be taken by these people and later we'll figure out what to do with those portfolios. So all this detailed stuff is now available. If you ask me, once you pick up all these archival documents and stuff, it's very difficult to see how you can argue that Nehru had intended to keep Sardar Patel out. At the same time, there is plenty of archival evidence to show that there were differences between them. There were strong differences and arguments between them. It's also true that Sardar Patel was much older than Nehru. Sardar Patel was in fact born in 1875. Nehru was born in 1889. So Sardar Patel was 14 years older than Nehru, just 6 years younger than Mahatma Gandhi. And then the other theoretical idea that if Sardar Patel had become the first prime minister and carried on, the fate of India would have been very different. I mean, these are eternal arguments. Nobody can win them. Nobody can lose them. The fact is that Sardar Patel's health was not very good. It had begun to decline quite rapidly in 1949. By 1950, mid-1940, he was in a very bad way. Late 1950, he was shifted to Bombay. for medical treatment, and he wasn't getting better. He was vomiting blood. Chest infections, particularly tuberculosis, those days was a big killer. Streptomycin had just come in, and two great figures of that period were suffering from crippling and fatal terminal chest problems. Who were those two? They were the two big warriors, Sardar Patel on this side, and he passed away in 1950 at what was then the ripe age of 75 in 1950. And Muhammad Ali Jinnah, who passed away, he was a year younger than Sardar Patel, he passed away in 1948 itself, again because of tuberculosis. He also passed away vomiting blood. So these are those eternal controversies and eternal mysteries. You can write a novel tomorrow imagining that these two had lived another 5, 7, 10 years, maybe the fate of the subcontinent would have been different. But they were not fated to live much longer than they did. Having said so, it's a brilliant cast of characters. Bose, Jinnah, Patel, Nehru, Gandhi, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, all the others around them, they were all supremely talented, brave people who spent years and years and years in jail, who suffered. To spend a night in a jail is not a picnic. Ask anybody, and I know many people who spend time in jail. They spent years and years and years in jail and exile, and they took lathis, and they all suffered, but they also, each one of them, had a mind of their own. So once again, fascinating to read that history, fascinating to see the binaries between them, who the points they agreed on, the points they disagreed on. It will always make a great movie. In between all of them, you had Lord Mountbatten, who many historians have also, he was a bumbler, but many historians have also described him as a schemer who wanted to balkanize India. In fact, Narayani Basu also claims that her great-grandfather prevented the balkanization of India, which was Mountbatten's idea. I'm sure we'll hear more about that. But he was also seen as a megalomaniac who boasted and bragged a great deal. In fact, if you read Jairam Ramesh's book on Krishna Menon, it is Mountbatten who in mid-50s, late-50s, is leading, he is spearheading the move to make India buy more and more and more British weapons. So no character is ever perfect. Even our gods are not perfect. Everybody has flaws. All these people had flaws. But the beautiful thing is they've all left you archives, recordings, paperwork for you to refer to and to argue over their history.